Hello guys, welcome back to another video. Epic Games just released the first official preview version of Unreal Engine 5.3 on the Epic Games launcher the other day. I know it's crazy, 5.2 was only released about a couple of months ago. So in this video, we'll be going over everything new inside of Unreal Engine 5.3, all the major feature updates and everything you need to know. But there are so many new features, including updates to Nanite and Lumen that include major performance updates, updates to the rendering, including Path Tracer now supporting Substrate and Niagara Fluids, huge updates to open worlds in Unreal Engine 5 such as Nanite landscapes and support for importing large landscape resolutions, and so much more. Now before we get into the video, I want to really quickly tell you about my multiplayer survival game course. There's over 50 plus hours of course content. In this course, you will learn how to make things like a drag and drop inventory system, a complete crafting system where you can craft all sorts of different items, a harvesting system where you can chop down any tree, rock or bush that you see on the map. We create 9 unique weapons and tools, things like a rocket launcher, pickaxe, hatchet, rifle. We create an entire building system where you can build your own bases using foundations, walls, ceilings, and you can upgrade your base from wood to then stone and then to metal. This course is currently in early access, but if you enroll today, you'll get a big early access discount. The price of this course will be raised later on, but if you enroll now, you'll get access to the entire course and all future lectures that will be added. So take your game development skills to the next level by enrolling in this course. The link will be in the description below, or you can head over to smartpoly.teachable.com to check out the course. So right off the bat, we have some updates for Nanite. Nanite now supports explicit tangents in the data format and runtime. Basically, a tangent is this line between the two vertices on a model, and you can see how the implicit tangents get sort of this crease on the edge, and it doesn't look good. Users can now choose whether or not to use the original model tangents on a per asset basis, and from my understanding, this is mainly for low poly meshes where you have sort of this sharp edge. Now next up, we have a new experimental feature for Nanite, a new Nanite spline mesh component. Splines are very useful for creating levels in environments where you need to manipulate a mesh around an area. For example, there are things like road splines, landscape splines, and now we have experimental support for Nanite enabled on the spline meshes. And it'll just be interesting to see how this all works. Now we have big performance improvements for Nanite masked foliage, and this is a huge 20% speed improvement for the rasterization of masked Nanite foliage. Lumen is also getting a couple of new updates in 5.3. Lumen reflection now supports more than one bounce when hardware ray tracing is enabled, with hit lighting and max reflection bounces in the post process volume set to 2 or greater. This can be used to prevent black areas and reflections when there is enough performance budget to allow it. As you can see in the image there, Lumen reflections can now also be used without Lumen global illumination for games and applications which want to use static lighting but also want to scale up the reflection quality beyond reflection capture. So that's kind of interesting, because say you don't want to use Lumen dynamic lighting but rather you want to use static lighting, but now you can have static lighting plus high quality Lumen reflections. Now they've made significant Lumen hardware ray tracing optimizations, including enabling async compute for hardware ray tracing by default on consoles. They fixed the material ambient occlusion as previously applied on top of emissive and direct lighting. And there's also a lot more fixes and updates to Lumen. These are just to name a few. But as for rendering, we have quite a bit of updates, including a new experimental orthographic rendering view. Orthographic has always been a camera option inside of Unreal Engine, but now rendering as orthographic view is supported as experimental feature. We also have lots of updates to the path tracer if you are a film enthusiast. We have things like path tracer now supports heterogeneous volumes such as smoke, fire, and clouds that you can create using the Niagara Fluids plugin. Substrate materials is also now supported within path tracer as well. Debuffer, decal, shader nodes, and material graphics have added support as well. And the post-process material buffers now have additional outputs for use specifically with the path tracer. We are also getting some updates for substrate, the new experimental material system. Substrate is still experimental in 5.3, but now it supports some new features such as new glints and specular profiles, mainly for automotive applications, improved debuffer shading node support, a new fuzz model for high-spec platforms, and updates to the substrate material editor tab, and many bug fixes and performance improvements. Virtual shadow maps is also getting updated in 5.3 and is officially moving out of the beta and now considered production ready. Virtual shadow maps now respect the Nanite cold distance even when shadow caching is enabled, and just just additional bug fixes and performance improvements. Hair is also getting a big update inside of Unreal Engine 5.3. Basically, Groom is the hair system, and they're adding streaming support for Groom and Groom binding assets. This allows faster loading time in editor and in game by loading only what is needed, lowering CPU and GPU memory pressure for Groom assets. And just to name a few, they're adding continuous LOD for scaling and improvement performance when there's a lot of Grooms covering a smaller portion of the screen, and of course many additional bug fixes and performance improvements for Groom assets. Now, world building, specifically open world maps and landscapes, are getting a huge update inside of Unreal Engine 5.3, and this is probably the feature I'm most excited about because it has been ages since Epic has released any sort of update to the landscape system in Unreal Engine. Nanite now can be enabled on landscape actors, and Nanite landscape meshes can be rebuilt in the background in order to not disrupt user workflow while in the editor. Nanite landscapes does not improve landscape resolution, but it allows the user to leverage all the Nanite runtime features such as GPU culling, automatic geometry streaming, LODs, and it generally boosts the runtime performance. Another big update is the support for large landscapes import and export. So import and export landscape has been updated in order to support very large landscape resolutions by leveraging world partition and splitting the import operation into several successive batches. Now this is what I'm very interested to see how it works, because currently at the moment you can't really import a large landscape into Unreal Engine, because when they switch from Unreal Engine 4 to Unreal Engine 5, they switch the world composition to world partition. And what this changed is you can't import a tiled landscape, but rather you have to import a single high resolution height map and have world partition split it up into tiles, which just the importing process was way too performance intensive, especially if you have a really high resolution or large map and you just need an insane amount of RAM to import it. So yeah, it'll be interesting to see how this changes in Unreal Engine 5.3. So I'm going to be making some pretty big open world maps and combine that with the Nanite landscapes. This is just going to be absolutely huge. We also have level streaming persistence, which is a experimental plugin. This manages saving and restoration of specific mark properties on objects containing within the streamed out and in level. These properties are defined within the engine configuration INI file. They've also added future landscape LOD groups that enable seamless LOD transition across multiple landscape actors within the same group. These are just to name a few of the updates coming to world building inside of Unreal Engine 5.3. Now there's quite a bit more of updates, including some new updates to PCG, or the procedural content generation. PCG is exploding in popularity with what we saw it was capable of inside of the Electric Dreams demo, and there's just so many different types of things you can use PCG for. And in 5.3 we have a new hierarchical generation which allows for execution of different grid sides within the same PCG graph. So you can see this brand new node grid size. You can define where the points should be sampled in within that defined grid size. PCG now supports rule processing from external data, providing future parity with the CD Sample Project Rule Processor plugin to manage external data, process it, and produce artifacts on target actors. So if you look at this, you can see they took the data from the CD Sample map and they've generated all these points to show you they can actually recreate the city using PCG. Now this is potentially huge because the city sample map was created using an external program like Houdini, but now we're getting these updates to PCG to potentially have the same sort of procedural tools and capabilities built into the engine. Now these are just a few updates to PCG. There's a lot more other stuff. There are a couple more updates to different platforms such as XR, mobile, and Apple M2 devices. Nanite is now supported on Apple M2 devices, and honestly I'm not a big Apple guy, so I'm not entirely sure which devices this applies to. Characters and animations are getting a lot more features in Unreal Engine 5.3. Unreal is now turning into a 3D application where you can 3D model a mesh, unwrap it, texture it, and now you can actually rig it. Yes, you heard me right. Now you can actually weight paint a mesh, add bones, remove bones, and modify bones with the new experimental skeletal mesh editor. The skeletal mesh editor enables users to create skeletons and edit mesh skin weights directly inside of Unreal Engine. This tool offers fast faster iterations by allowing the addition of bones to your assets, as well as deformation on static meshes, converting them to skeletal meshes all in one place without the need for importing skeleton data. Now, there are a lot more updates that I haven't covered yet, things like virtual production, simulation, audio, modeling tools. And so if you guys want to check out the full roadmap, I'll leave a link in the description below. Just looking back at all this stuff like this, it's kind of crazy to think about all of the new features that Unreal Engine has added over the years. I mean, we have things like Nanite, Control Rig, Niagara, PCG, and it's just crazy to think about how Unreal Engine has evolved over the years. I mean, I remember using Unreal Engine 4 and it didn't have any of these new features. It was just a simple game engine. And I can't really think of any other program that comes close or is comparable to the engine. Now, let me know which particular category you guys are most interested in down in the comments down below. Are you interested in the new character and animation updates, virtual production updates, or world building? Me in particular, I'm excited to try out the new landscapes inside of Unreal Engine 5.3, and it just seems like they're pumping out new versions of the engine every few months or so. I mean, Unreal Engine 5.2 isn't even that old. It was only released about 2 months ago. Anyways, that is going to be it for this video. Subscribe if you want more Unreal Engine updates. I'll be covering the news on Unreal Engine 5.3 that comes out. And yeah, that's going to be it for this video. Hope you guys enjoyed, and I'll see you guys in the next one.